Are you doing all right?
Yeah.
All right. I want to say one more time, if you are a guest or a visitor in our house, we are so glad that you're here. And I have just a couple things I want to tell you about before we get going into the actual message. The first one, and I normally say this at the beginning, but I want to say this right now. There's some Connect cards in front of you, in the pew in front of you. If you've never filled one of those out, whether you've been going here for forever or if this is your first time, would you just fill one of those out? And as we're shaking hands, as we get ready to leave, you can just hand that to me or somebody in the sound room. And we're not going to harass you with emails. I usually send out one a week. We just want you to be aware of what's going on in our church so that you can be a part of it. And the next thing I want to remind you about, and it's so easy to lose sight of this, is be inviting people to church. People won't come if you don't invite them. 100% of the people that you don't ask to come to church won't come. And I heard a statistic this week that 85% of people who are in church came to church because a friend invited them. And so as we lead up to the Easter season, Arvin told us this week, it's 7 weeks out. Let's be inviting people. Let's be expecting people. And I also heard that 50%, one out of two people who you ask to church will come with you. And so do whatever it takes to get them here. If you have to buy them a meal after church, do it. If you have to say, I will help you out at work, or I'll mow your yard, do what it takes to get them to come, because we believe that the message that we have works. We believe that it will change lives. And if you can get them here, they'll hear the good news. I promise you that. And one more thing before we get into the actual message. We all have a story, okay? Everybody in this house has a story. And we would like to know what your story is. And so if you have a story about what Jesus is doing in your life right now, if you have a story about how this church has helped you or encouraged you or moved you closer to the Lord, you can email us that story at mystory@bombbaptist.com. And we would love to hear from you. If you have a suggestion maybe for us or a prayer request, you can email us at mystory@bombbaptist.com. And we would love to hear your stories. We won't share them with anybody unless we ask you, okay? So you don't have to worry about one day you coming in here and us telling your story and you not knowing about it. So if you have a story you'd like to share, you can email that to us at mystory@bombbaptist.com. And so with all of that housekeeping stuff out of the way, let's get to the message. For the last few weeks, we've been talking about focus, and today I want us to talk about taking our focus off of the things of this world and looking forward to focus on heaven. And so, if you have your Bible, you can turn over to Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11, that's towards the very end. And if you don't have a Bible with you, you can, there's a gold Bible right there in front of you, in the pew in front of you. You can open that up and read it while you're here. But if you don't have a Bible and you'd like to have one, you can take that home with you. That is our gift to you today. So Hebrews 11. Before we get into this, I want to give you a little background about Hebrews and about Hebrews 11. We really don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews. We're not really sure. We think it was Paul, but nobody really knows for sure. There's no way to confirm without a shadow of doubt who wrote the book of Hebrews. So today when I talk about Hebrews, I'll just say the author. I personally think that it was Paul because of the way it's written, but we really don't know. So I can't tell you who for sure wrote it, but we do know that it was written to a group of Jews so that the Jews could see that Jesus was the fulfillment of the Jewish system. And so it was it's written in a form that says it explains the old system, and then it shows how Jesus was superior to that system. So the author will explain the old sacrifice system, and then he will say Jesus was our better sacrifice. And so that's how the whole book is written. And in Hebrews 11, it's called the Hall of Faith. And it talks about all of the heroes of the faith from the time of Abraham all the way up until the end of the Old Testament. And whoever the author is explaining all of the awesome, amazing things that these people have done, but he always starts off with, by faith they done this. By faith they done this. By faith they done this. But he starts the chapter off by explaining what faith is, and faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And so the author always says, by faith Abraham left the land that he knew and went into a land that he didn't. Or by faith Noah built an ark when he had seen no rain. Or by faith Sarah conceived a child even though she was an old woman. And so faith is believing against the odds. Faith is believing when you can't see. Faith is the evidence that causes you to believe something that there is no evidence for. And then in Hebrews 11:13, which is where we're going to pick up today, here is what the author says. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. And if they had been thinking of the land from which they had gone out, they would have an opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for He has prepared for them a city. Would you pray with me? Father, we acknowledge this morning that we are totally 100% dependent on You. Father, we need You more than we need anything else in life. Father, we need You. We need You in this message. Open our eyes and our ears to hear what You want us to hear. Father, I pray that You'd give me the very words to say and that You'd hide me behind Your cross. Father, more than ever, I know that I am insufficient. I'm not enough. But God, would You be enough where I am not? You be sufficient where I am insufficient. We love You this morning and we need You. And through Jesus we pray. So some of you may know and some of you may not. When I was about 5 or 6, we lived in Greyhawk. And then when I was five or six, Mom and Dad built a house in Sand Gap. And we moved from Greyhawk to Sand Gap. And it's a beautiful house on Pine Grove. If you're out through there, you can see it. But I lived in that house for about 16 years. Right up until 7 months ago when I moved over here to Bond, Kentucky. And I really love where I live now, but I'll just be honest with you, sometimes I get homesick. There's not a whole lot to see in Sand Gap, I'll just be honest with you, but sometimes I miss that long drive home across 290 and down 421 and up 1955 to get home. Sometimes I just miss that. And if you get car sick, I bet you wouldn't miss that. But I just miss going home sometimes. And have you ever felt homesick? Maybe you had to be away for a while. Maybe you went on a trip, or maybe you was on business somewhere, or maybe you've moved away and you miss a place called home. Have you been homesick before? It's an odd sensation, homesick is. It's like your body is in one place, but your heart is in another. It's your body is in here, but your heart is somewhere maybe far away. Sometimes when you're away from home, you just miss the smell Everybody's house has a smell. You may not think your house has a smell, but it does. And so sometimes when you're away from home, you miss the smell of home, or maybe you miss the comfort of your own bed, or you miss the familiarity of your home. But sometimes you just want to be back home. And it's an odd feeling, but I believe that this idea of homesick is the idea that the author of Hebrews is conveying about these people who live their life by faith, but at the end of their life, they still had a desire in their heart. They had had a promise from God that they hadn't seen the answer to. They'd all been promised different things, but they hadn't seen the promise fulfilled, but yet they were still looking for that promise to be fulfilled. They were still looking for something to happen. They were still believing that God would do what He said He would do. And so it says that they were strangers and exiles here on earth, but they were looking for a better country. They were looking for a better city, a heavenly city. They died believing that even if God had not fulfilled His promise here on earth, that He would still fulfill that promise one day, somehow, some way. They died believing God for that which they had not seen. And one of the things that they had been promised was a son. They had been promised a son through whom all of the earth would be blessed. And they were promised a land for their descendants of milk and honey. And these people, they didn't see that son and they didn't see this land here on earth, but there would be one day after these people were long gone and His name would be Jesus, and that son would open up an opportunity for that land flowing with milk and honey. And that land that was promised to these heroes of the faith is a place that we call heaven. They had a glimpse, an earthly glimpse of what was to come. And the first thing that it says is they acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on earth. They realized that this world was not really their home. It may be where their body was for a season, but this was not really their home. Have you ever been in a crowded room and you just didn't feel like you belonged? Like there was something different about you. Everybody else had something in common, but you felt a little different. You felt like you just didn't belong. Maybe you were with people who you hadn't hung out with in a while. Maybe they were doing things that you didn't exactly approve of. And in a place where you used to fit in, you no longer felt comfortable. Have you experienced that before? That this idea of, I used to fit in here, but I no longer do. I used to love being here, but that's not the feeling that I'm experiencing any longer. I think that is what the feeling of these people were. They felt like they used to belong here on earth. Something has happened and I no longer feel like I belong here. They felt like an outsider even when they were on the inside. So I want to make something clear this morning. I love the United States of America. I'm glad that I was born in this country. I think it's still the greatest country on earth. But I'm holding a dual citizenship here. I may be a citizen of the United States. I was born in the United States, and because of that, I am a citizen here. But I was born again as a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. And I'm just living here in the States until I get an opportunity to live with Christ in heaven. I'm just here on a temporary basis. I'm just here for a little while. I don't have plans of staying here for long. I'm just here until my home is ready in heaven. I'm just here for a short time. Jesus said, if I go away, I'll come back. But while I'm gone, I will prepare you a place. And if I go and prepare you a place, I'll come back for you. I have a home in construction in heaven. I have a home that is being prepared for me. And I can look forward in the deepest, darkest days of my life here on earth and I can say, hey, I'm just here on a short-term basis. I'm a stranger here on earth. I used to feel like I fit in on earth. I used to feel like this is where I belong, but when Jesus done a work in my heart, there's something that says on the inside of me, this is not all that there is. There has to be something more than what I'm experiencing right now. I believe that when you give your life to Jesus, when you become a Jesus follower, that the Holy Spirit moves in inside of you. And that Holy Spirit who has been to heaven and seen heaven and has experienced heaven, it starts longing. It starts churning something up on the inside of you that desires to be where you truly belong, where you really fit in. And when life gets hard and when circumstances are difficult, that Holy Spirit starts longing to be home. Have you had that happen to you, that in a deep, dark valley of your life, when the pain is overwhelming, your heart just longed for heaven? Like, God, would you just come and get me right now, because I'm tired of this pain, tired of these circumstances. I want to be home. Sometimes you just feel like you're not at home in this world anymore. Jesus said, you are in this world, but you are no longer of this world. You are not like the world. You are a stranger, an alien in this world. Says that they were seeking a homeland. They were seeking a homeland. That means that nowhere they went as they traveled satisfied their souls. Have you ever been gone away from home for a while, and when you came home and you finally got to sit down in your chair and you finally got to lay down in your bed, you just took a sigh of relief and said, I am glad to be home. Amen. There's nothing like home. But yet, these people, they looked over here and they looked over there and they sought out a homeland, but nowhere they could find could satisfy them as home. We can feel a temporary satisfaction with our home here on earth. But our souls are longing to be at home, where our souls can find rest and relaxation. We need a heavenly home. They had faith that God had something prepared for them that they could not experience on this side of glory. They had faith that God had something better prepared for them on the other side of life. When I was in fifth grade, I'd been hunting for a little while, and my cousin Brian, he always took me out, and he showed me the ropes of hunting and all the things that go along with that. And I never could seem to kill a deer, okay? And it wasn't because I couldn't shoot. It was that I could never see the deer. They would be right out there in the field, and I just couldn't seem to see them. And Brian, he saw that there was a problem with the way my eyes were working, okay? And he said, listen, he told my parents, this boy is blind. You need to go have him checked out. He can't see anything. And so my parents took me to the eye doctor, and they diagnosed me with nearsightedness. Nearsightedness. That means that when I don't have my contacts in, if it's about right here, I can see it. But if it's any farther than that, I have problems focusing on things that are away from me. There would be no hope of me telling who was sitting in the back of the church if I didn't have my contacts in. And so I got some contacts and got some glasses, and I've had to wear those ever since because I can't see anything without them. But I feel like that as a church, not just us as a church, but us as Church Universal, we suffer from some spiritual nearsightedness. We see the here and now. We see the things that are present. We see the things that are close up. But when it gets any farther than a day or a week or a year ahead, we have trouble focusing. We have trouble seeing the things that are on down the road. We get so focused on work or school and bills or sports that we can't see what we ought to be looking at. We can't see what we ought to be focused on. And that's heaven. If we get so caught up in this life, if we get so caught up in all the things that we have to do today that we lose sight of heaven, we may not do anything that we really need to do. So many times we get caught up in the short term, in the temporary, in the here and now. But life is just a moment. I know that the bills, they seem important, but one day those bills won't really matter. I know that the money, it seems important right now, but one day that money won't matter. Money is just, it's just paper with green dye on it, okay? It's just paper. I know I'm not encouraging you to throw all your money away. Stop focusing on it. It's temporary. It's temporary. If we could understand just how long that eternity is, we would not worry so much about what we do here on earth. Eternity has no end. Your life will have an end. Earth will have an end, but eternity has no end. So I believe that as a church, as individuals, we need to put some spiritual glasses on this morning so that we can see clearly eternity, so that we can put our focus on things of eternity. And I believe that if we do this, three things are going to happen to us. And so if you're taking notes, I want you to write these three things down. If you're not taking notes, write them down anyway, because I worked hard to make them all start with a P, okay? I worked hard. I spent time on this. I need you to write it down. All right, number one. The first thing that will happen when you get your eyes on eternity is that your possessions will lose their position. Your possessions will lose their position. See, for many of us today, our possessions, the things we own, the things we work for, they have a position in our life. They have a position of prominence. They take first seat in our life. We're always worried about how to keep our things. So worried about how to gather more things. We're concerned. We buy security systems and locks and gates and fences to keep our things. We spend a majority of our time worried about, are all my things here? Has someone stolen my things? We worry about what happens to me if I lose everything. What would happen if today I lost it all? When we really don't realize that if we lost everything today, every earthly possession, in light of eternity, we would not have really lost anything at all. If you lost it all in light of eternity, you would not have lost anything at all. It's just stuff. It's just things. We need to realize that one day, all those things will be gone. When you die, your things won't matter anymore. Your things won't matter anymore. It won't matter how shiny your car was. It won't matter how new of a vehicle you drove. It won't matter how your lawn looked. It will matter the condition of your soul. Amen. When you get your eyes on eternity, your possessions will lose their position. We get so obsessed with money. We get so obsessed with things. We get so obsessed with all of the things that we can see and touch and feel. But Jesus would say in Mark 8:36, what would it profit a man if he got everything in the world, if he gathered up everything there was to get and lost his soul? What would he have gained in the end? I think what Jesus was trying to tell us is, you have to look at your thing through the lens of eternity. Because all of those things, everything you own, it will burn up on this earth one day. There's coming a day and everything you see on earth will be destroyed. And in light of that, nothing that we really do, in light of the things, really matters. Most of the things you buy today won't amount to a hill of beans tomorrow. You can pay $30,000 for a new car today, and in 10 years you can't give it away. Things don't matter. When you set your eyes on eternity, your possessions lose their position of prominence in your life. Take your eyes off of your things and put them on things that make an eternal difference. What are you doing today that will matter 100 years from now? What are you putting your effort in today that will matter, I mean really matter, 100 years from today? Number two, second thing that will happen, is your pain will lose its power. Your pain will lose its power. Has anybody experienced any pain this week? Maybe physical pain, maybe emotional pain, maybe mental pain, but you have experienced some pain in some form or another this week. I have. And sometimes in life we get so focused on our pain, and our pain feels like it's overwhelming us. It feels like that we're in this valley, and it, like David describes it in Psalms 23, that it's a valley of the shadow of death. Like pain is overcoming us, that pain is overwhelming us. Have you experienced that kind of pain? If you've not, chances are you will. But when we have our eyes on eternity, we realize that our pain is temporary. Our pain is temporary. That means that even the most grueling, excruciating pain will only last for a brief moment in comparison to eternity. So whatever you may be going through, whatever you may be facing, you can have hope today that it won't last. It won't last. That's a message for somebody in the house this morning, that you may be going through the dark season of your life. You may be going through the worst moments of your life. You may be going through terrible things, but let me make you a promise, it won't last. It may last for a little while, but it won't last forever. It won't last. Pain is temporary. Eternity is forever. David would say in the book of Psalms that weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. What he was saying is, your pain will have an end. Your pain will have an end. Your pain has lost its power because we realize that it won't last forever. I'm not trying to belittle your pain. I'm not trying to minimize your pain. I'm sure that there's people going through things in this building this morning that I could only imagine. But no matter how bad it may be, it won't last. Think of it this way. Your worst day on earth is your worst day ever. If you are a follower of Jesus. And if you can get through that worst day, if you can push through that darkest hour, you have nowhere to go but up. Because when we get to heaven, there will be no more pain, there will be no more sorrow, there will be no more heartache. Your worst day on earth will be your worst day ever. But your greatest day on earth, it can't even compare to what heaven will be like. Your greatest day, the day you had the most joy, it can't even compare to what heaven will be like. I don't know what heaven will be like. I don't have a list of scriptures about what it may or may not happen there. But I promise you this. Your greatest day can't even compare to what our Heavenly Father has in store when we get there. Me and Brody were talking yesterday evening, and we were talking about how good of a carpenter Jesus must have been. And what we said was that if people can accomplish so much in such a short time here on earth, what's heaven going to look like if Jesus has been preparing for so long? Heaven will be an amazing place. Our darkest hour cannot compare to what heaven will be like. And Paul says it this way in Romans 8. He says, the Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with Him in order that we may be glorified with Him. Listen to this. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Paul said, whatever you're going through, it's worth it. Whatever you have to face, it's worth it. Whatever you may go through, it can't even begin to compare to the weight of what heaven will be like. Your worst day on earth is your worst day ever. Our pain has lost its power. Oh death, where is your victory? Oh pain, where is your sting? Our pain has lost its power. So when we get focused on eternity, our possessions will lose their position. Our pain will lose its power. And our purpose becomes precise. God has a purpose for your life. You may feel like that you don't have a purpose. You may feel like that God can't use you. You may feel like that you aren't good for nothing, or that you are dried up, and that God can no longer do anything with your life. But God has given you a unique set of gifts, talents, and abilities because He has a mission, a purpose that only you can accomplish. Think about that. God has a purpose that only you can accomplish. When you get your eyes on eternity, you see a little more clearly what this purpose really is. God may have given you the abilities, the talents to be a carpenter, but your purpose on earth is not to build houses. Not your ultimate purpose. No, God gave you those abilities as a carpenter because He was going to have you infiltrate the field of carpentry. And He was going to send you into that field as a workplace missionary. He gave you those skills so that you could earn respect from the people you work around, so that you can ultimately point back to Him and bring people to Him in that field. You may be a teacher. Your degree may say that you're a teacher, but your ultimate purpose is not to teach kids math. That's a good thing. You should do that. But your job title may be teacher, but your purpose is an educational missionary. You may be a computer programmer, but your purpose is not to design software, it's to infiltrate a field as a missionary. You're to go in those places. You were made with the purpose to go in the places where you are, to be around the people that you are around, so that you can bring God glory, so that you can lead people to Christ, so that you can invite people into the family of God, so that you can be around the people to develop the relationships, to invite them to come to church, so that when they come to church, they can hear a message about Jesus. And when they hear that message about Jesus, they give their life to Him. And then they go do the same thing, and you, in one moment, in one career, even though you don't feel like you're making an impact, you might see thousands of people saved because of one person you share Christ with. God has you where you are for a purpose. God has you where you are for a reason. He has you in a place of influence so that you can influence people for the cause of Christ. Your purpose is precise. He wants you to make waves where you are for the cause of Christ. Wherever that may be, we're to make an impact in this world for Jesus. That is our purpose. When you can see through all of your job tasks and all of your responsibilities, and you can see that they may have hired me to do this job. They may have hired me because of a set of skills that I have or an education that I have, but God put me here for a reason. God put me here. Did you know your employer didn't hire you? God put you where you are for a reason. He put you there on purpose, for a purpose, and that purpose is to bring the world to Him. As I get ready to close today, I want you to know that heaven is not something to dread or fear. But heaven is something for us to look forward to and long for. It's something for us in our deepest, darkest valleys to be able to look up out of all that junk and say, I may be in a dark place in my life right now, but I'm going to push on for that which is ahead of me. I'm going to push on because that which is ahead of me is worth all that is behind me. I'm going to push on towards heaven. I'm looking forward to a place where there is no more hurt. There is no more betrayal. There is no more pain. There is no more stress. There is no more disease. There is no more bad. I'm looking forward to taking that last breath here on earth and taking my first breath in heaven so that I can see face to face the man who died for me. I'm looking forward to the day when I can run into the arms of my Savior and He'll hold me forevermore. You can turn on the news today and on any channel you'll find hurt, you'll find violence, you'll find agony. But there's coming a day where there will be no more of that. You won't need Fox News in heaven to tell you all the bad things that have happened, because there will only be good news there. Today, I want you to know that if you are a believer in Jesus, if you have followed Jesus, heaven is your final destination. But if you're here today and you don't know, you say, Cody, that all sounds great, but I'm not sure what my eternal home is. I have good news for you. And the good news is that you can't make it to heaven on your own. The good news is that you can't come to church enough to get into heaven. You can't sing enough Christian songs or listen to enough Christian songs to get you into heaven. You can't help enough homeless. You can't feed enough hungry to get you into heaven. There's one way to this place called heaven. And His name is Jesus. And He came because He knew we couldn't get there on our own. And He lived 33 years perfect as the Son of God. And then He done the most unimaginable thing that we could think of. He paid our debt. The debt we could not pay, He paid it. He bridged the gap between heaven and earth so that one day we could be with Him forever. I heard this week that Jesus must be a great carpenter because He built a bridge between heaven and earth with only two pieces of wood. The cross built the bridge so that we could get to God. And all you have to do is believe this message, believe that He came and that He died and that He paid our price and that He rose again on the third day. Romans 10 says, if you'll believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. Believe this message about Jesus and make Him Lord of your life and you will be saved. And heaven will be your eternal home. Today, as we get ready to go, I want everybody in the house to bow your head and close your eyes. And if you have made the decision today, yes, I want heaven to be my home. Yes, I want to make the decision to follow Jesus today. I want you to pray this prayer with me. I want you to pray this prayer and nobody in the house looking. We're all heads bowed and eyes closed. You can just say, Lord, I realize that I am a sinner and that I could never make it to You on my own. I realize that I deserve hell. I deserve to be punished for what I've done. But would You forgive me? I accept the sacrifice You made for me on the cross. I want you to be Lord of my life. Guide me for the rest of my life. Save me from my sin. In Jesus' name. With everybody still heads bowed, if you decided to pray that prayer for the first time today, would you just raise your hand? If that was your decision today to follow Jesus, thank you for those hands. Church, I want us to remember the sacrifice made for us so that we could inherit heaven. Right now, the altar is going to be open. If you need to pray, if you have a situation you need to talk about, I'd love to talk about that with you. Would you just consider heaven for a few moments? Would you think about how good it must be? And how much God must love us to give us that. The altar's open. You can do whatever you need to in this moment.